Okay. So thank you for coming to my talk. So let's talk about functional programming, in particular how to make functional programs run faster. This is basically the main topic of our research team in the company. We are crazy about performance, and we emphasize functional approach and high-performance functional programming in particular. So I would like to say thank you to organizers who put my talk after the previous one, because I don't need to motivate you if you was on the previous presentation, because now you know why we need to use functional programming in large-scale application. So basically, the global properties of the functional programs are usually better compared to imperative ones. So they are more predictable, robust, composable. And if we're talking about performance, it even may be more responsive and better for parallelism. So roughly 80% of the program is okay in terms of performance. But 20% we need to have special care. So we have a hotspots in our program which we need to take care of. So consider this simple example of matrix vector multiplication. This is a very short one-line program which is purely functional. It takes some matrix, which is abstract data type, and the vector, which is also abstract data type, and produce some new vector, which is also abstract data type. What we know is that we can construct vector from values, we can retrieve rows from this, from the matrix, and we can multiply two vectors. And this is all you need to know about matrix vector multiplication if you run it in a functional declarative way. But what if this code is part of a hotspot and runs like millions times in a second? So it should have. The performance is important. So let's try load some matrix vectors, put it into dense representation of matrix and vectors. So this is two classes which implement this abstract interfaces matrix and vector. And call this method, call this function MVM, and test it on different data with different sparseness, and we get these numbers. So the question is it good enough in terms of performance or not? So if we compare with this program, which is actually not functional, it is an imperative program, we will see that the performance can be increased in 40 times. So obviously the first version is not acceptable if you care about performance. Another example, if we, for example, want to zip some collection of values with index for some reason, and we want to abstract from what is our collection and what is our state. We can use state monad, for example, abstraction here. And this is an algorithm how to we can implement the zip collection with vector. And we don't want to change it later, because this is already abstraction from all the different representation of both collection and state. Another example is, for example, if we consider composable application architecture, which this is example from Runner's presentation from last Scala days in Berlin. This is how we can express some applications and some particular scenario where we can interact with the user, we can perform authentication, and also do other kind of logic of application. we want to write this code because we can abstract from the interpretation of this code. We can interpret it in different kinds of monads, like testing monads and like identity monads or some kind of different monads. We can decide it later. So in some sense, what we want to really execute is if our monad is just interpretation of this application and this logic using console operations, then this, we want to execute this code. So then this kind of motivation, we have some examples where we have functional programs which abstracts from many different points, and we would like to keep this code as it is. But so why do bad things happen to good people? It's because for performance reasons, we kind of need to go down to earth. And manually, we do such usually bad things. We remove lambdas, we perform defunctionalization, we do specialization. Like, for example, we can select different data representations and so on. We introduce specific mechanisms like caching, allocation. We can make acceleration using C++, using GNI or unsafe, for example. We can even offload computation to GPU and perform different transformations with data structures. So what is the point? The point is that we don't really want to change the code. The code is already in a good shape. It was designed by us or somebody who is even smarter. Why we should want to change it at all? Just because of performance. So the idea is that instead, teach the compiler to generate an efficient code for a given hotspot. But don't ever change the code. So this is the message. So this is example of beautiful code. So it's nothing to add, nothing to remove. This is the logic which we don't want to change. So how we do this? We can take a hotspot. We can give this AST of this hotspot to Scala plugin, which inside Scala compiler. So this is just Scala code. We can annotate this hotspot. Then we take this AST and put it into some optimization framework, which specifically designed it for this hotspot, for this, such kind of hotspots. And then we generate a kernel, and then we replace the invocation of this hotspot with a new generated kernel. And this happens automatically during compilation time. Scalan is a framework for hotspot optimizers. So if you have a hotspot and this is a functional program and you want to keep this source code as it is, but teach the compiler how to compile it more efficiently, then you can use Scalan to describe the domain, describe the algebraic properties of the domain, annotate the hotspot, and then put this to the component which we call Scalanizer. Is a Scala plugin which takes Scala code, regular Scala code, and transform it into intermediate representation which is used inside Scala. And this is called code virtualization, similar to the idea of Scala virtualized approach, but we are not implemented it on the surface of the language. It is completely hidden from the programmer. It's inside the compiler. And then we can have a Scalan library which has some linear algebra domains, collections domains, graphs, functional programmings like monads, state monads, free monads, other kinds of monads. And also Scala Meta, which can generate some boilerplate, which has some semantic annotations for intermediate representation and for abstractions. And then all this information is necessary metadata and necessary information for some compilation pipeline. So we have in Scala and Core, we have common intermediate immutable graph-based intermediate representation. We have graph-based rewriting engine. We have isomorphic specialization agent. I will talk about it later. And we have multi-stage transformation pipeline, which you can configure for your hotspot and for particular domains. And then after this transformation, we can put the code into different backends. We have the bridge to LMS. We have bridge to Delight. We can generate Scala and C++ code. This is selected by the programmer. So the compilation pipeline of Scalain looks like this. So in Scala compiler, we have Scalanizer, then we have multi-stage transformation pipeline, and then we put the code into some LMS backend, Delight backend, or even Spark backend. So yes, we support Spark code generation. So the code, which is multiplying matrix to vector, can be automatically transformed into Spark application. Inside transformation pipeline, we have isomorphic specialization, which is main specialization techniques which allows such kind of transformations, which is based on rewrite rules engine, which transform graphs. And rewrite rules based on method of staging, which we call staged evaluation, which mimics the semantics of the Scala language in particular. And everything is based on immutable graph-based intermediate representation. And here is an example of the rules that actually graph rewriting rules, but looks like a term rewriting rules, just because they are implemented using first immutable graph-based representation. It's actually implemented in Scalan language itself using staged evaluation. And this forms a rewrite rule. So here's some demonstration how it may work. I hope you can see. Okay, so here's some test scenario. Yeah, sorry. Is it okay?
Yes.
Okay. So this is a test which takes we generates a random matrix, generate random vector, then we calculate some correct results using just some Scala code, then we. Heating up GVM a little bit, just two iterations. And then we perform a call to particular methods from linear algebra package, giving this input data to these methods. So let's try to run it. So you can see the calculated result is 3,080. Then we're heating up GVM for our hotspot. And then we get even a little bit faster implementation, which uses actually arrays. So if we look at the code of this implementation, so what we currently do? We take arrays as an input, then we put these arrays into some matrix implementation. We call it compound matrix, but it's actually like dense matrix representation. And then we call this abstract method MVM. What it does is it's what was on the slides. It just takes rows from the matrix, map each vector, then perform this multiplication of the vectors. So notice here that we have annotation. We can put it like, please consider this as a hotspot. And so we recompile this. One more time, this is expected. Okay, so run it again. Okay, so now the same code runs magically 10 times faster. Yeah. If we do a little bit more, we can cpp kernel do the same. Okay, rebuild. I rebuilt everything just to don't have any side effects here. Looks like we need one more time.
Right.
Okay, so usually, so actually what's going on is that compiler taking these annotations and apply different kernel generation. So here you see this is C++, and this is three more times efficient than previous version. So this happens automatically, and this is a kind of user experience that we think is good for hotspots. It's not good for whole program, but for hotspots in the program, it's kind of experience that I think is convenient. So back to the slides. Okay, so how actually it works? First, let's think about what is domain specific. So first of all, it's not a DSL. Basically, it's a family of types, the types that we use in our hotspot, and operations that are available for these types. And also cross-domain interactions. So, for example, if you look at this method of the matrix, it's actually so the domain of matrices interacts with the domain of vectors, and we should consider such kind of interactions. And this is an example domain implementation. So we, in our domain, we can have a bunch of different implementations that we know how to represent data of our domain. This is our programmer's choice. We need to explicitly tell how we want to represent matrices, how we want to represent vectors, and all this information already in the program. So in Scalan, we can take these domain-specific artifacts and apply previously mentioned optimization techniques, which for this hotspot, we can remove lambdas, do inlining, we can change a specific data representation, we can generate C++ code, which will be automatically called from Java, and do different things. So the central idea behind Scalan can be formulated like this. Say we have this example. This example is written in domain of linear algebra. Let's call it domain A. And let's say that for domain B, for example, arrays, Java arrays, we have some optimizing compiler. We use LMS in this prototype and in Scalan, which can generate efficient imperative code for some runtime, for example, for GVM or C++. So what we want is to have this automatic procedure, which we call automatic cross-domain translation, which can transform your program, original functional program, into the program in the domain for which you have optimizing compiler or some optimized runtime, like Spark, for example, is optimized runtime. It's also functional, and it has RDD abstractions, not arrays, but RDD. And you can transform your high-level program into more low-level program. And this is cross-domain, automatic cross-domain translation. So the questions, is it generic enough to handle all the programs in A? What about cross-domain programs? Is it possible to have multi-level translations, like from machine learning to linear algebra, from linear algebra to arrays, and so on? So it turns out that yes, the answer is yes for all three questions. And in order to understand how it works, let's first consider another topic. So how we can select the representation for example, for our matrix. So we can represent matrix in a dense format, like an array of arrays, each row in a single arrays. Or we can represent matrix in sparse format, where each row, so green row from here, can be represented as the indexes of non-zero elements, it's compressed row format. But alternatively, we can also implement matrix and use this representation of flat representation of matrix. And this is all our matrix. This is all the representation which form our matrix domain. So how we select for our particular hotspot, which one is better? So what we can do, we can try different representation by building this table. We take our data of different sparseness, we execute all these representations and get this table. What we see that every time we apply for different sparseness of the data, we have different winner. So one of the implementation is usually better than others. And how do you know in advance that this is a bad choice? For example, this is 50% sparseness. Okay, we can have some intuition that maybe sparse matrix multiplied by sparse vector is not clear how to implement Okay, it's maybe less clear than, for example, dense matrix, dense vector. Yeah, but how we know that this is also a bad choice comparing to the winner, which is sparse matrix and dense vector implementation? And what we do usually, we implement all these different versions. If we really care about performance, we should do this in order to say, yes, this is the most optimal and for ourselves. Can we automate such a specialization? And this how we come to the specialization technique and what kind of specialization we need. We call it isomorphic specialization because it emphasizes the use of isomorphisms between data types. So let's say we have program P from type A to type B, and also we have an isomorphism between type A and type A prime, and I may use color to denote this abstraction levels. The blue color is for abstract data types, and the orange color is for, it's orange, yeah, it's orange for more specific data types. And what the method of specialization is doing is automatically transform, automatically generates program P prime from A to B, where A prime is isomorphic to A and B prime is isomorphic to B. And so that this diagram actually commutes. So we're looking for such kind of program P prime. So isomorphic specialization is a systematic transformation of original program which removes all class-based abstractions from the program while keeping original semantics of the problem. It is implemented as a set of graph rewriting rules and thus can be easily combined with other transformations. So if we apply this to our matrix vector example, so we see that we have an isomorphism between matrix and a dense representation of arrays, and also we represent vectors as arrays, and this is postulated isomorphisms. This is not isomorphism that you can infer. You can postulate it to the system. And this is the main difference between isomorphic specialization and treatment of isomorphism that we use in our methods and how this isomorphism usually used in generic programming, for example, framework, where you can infer from algebraic data types some isomorphic representations of the data type. Here, it is postulated isomorphism. We as programmers know our domain and say, these types are isomorphic. And we provide this isomorphism as the first class constructions in our program. So if we look from diagrammatic point of view, we see that our dense matrix, dense vector multiplication is exactly the program that we want to find. And here we come to the notion of specializable by design abstractions. So how we construct them? First, we declare some interface, like vector or matrix. We have vector's domain, we have matrix domain. Then, in this domain, we decide we want to represent dense vector as just an array. And we use case class for this. And this is like generalized abstract data types, which we can, or just abstract data types we can declare for vector. And this is a family of types. So, and we take this knowledge that we construct this case class as we use this tuple, and this is how we get that array of T is isomorphic to the vector. So this is a conventional declaration of isomorphism. Every time we declare something like this, vector and some subtype of the vector, we declaring some isomorphism. And this is by design. So we have special annotation for such kind of classes like vector, that it is specializable by design. Not all declaration in Scala actually can be used like this. And another version, we, for example, can implement sparse matrix as two arrays and the length. So we keep indices of non-zero elements and we have values and we have length. And we say that vector is isomorphic to this tuple. And this is, again, a declaration. We can do the same for matrix. And once we have done this, we put isomorphic specialization in our pipeline. We take this example, we apply, we use this isomorphism, and we want to build this dense matrix, dense vector implementation using arrays. And then, putting this into LMS, we can generate this imperative loop. So this is a pipeline. We use combined approach. We first perform cross-domain translation into some domain for which we have efficient compiler or runtime, and then we apply what we already have in that domain. So in order to make it automatic and in order to actually generate this the body of this DMVM, what we can first look at what kind of body of this method we have. We call it wrap, apply, unwrap, three steps pattern. First, we take raw data in arrays. Then we wrap this data into some abstractions. We build dense matrix, we build dense vector, and then we put the, we call our abstract algorithm using concrete implementation. This is just the usual object-oriented practice, how we can abstract from some particular representation in object-oriented programs. And then when we get some abstract vector, we can unwrap it, extract values from this vector. And this is three steps that we use. And if we look at the diagram of isomorphic specialization, we see that actually this isomorphism is a wrapper where we put raw data into some abstraction. And this isomorphism is unwrapper. This is, they are mutually inverse. And these two parts of the isomorphism, isomorphism is two functions. One is in one direction, another in other direction, and they are mutually inverse. So, and the final trick is this. If we want to generate the body of the methods, we just need to apply staged evaluation of the body. So formally, we just apply this transformation to the whole body in the environment of the arguments. And then we get, as a result, this code, which is the code, which is... actually what happens is that this code actually consists of the part of the original domain abstraction implementations, which are in different places. They are taken together and put into some combination, which actually reflects the semantic of our implementation. So we published paper last year on the workshop. So it's going to be ICFP submission, but we did not prove a theorem yet. So we published on the workshop. Yet we are in the process of proving that it works always with some reasonable limitations and constraints. And this is how formulated staged evaluation. It's zipper-based traversal of the original program, so it's actually one of the three mutually recursive functions how this process works. But the good thing is that you don't need to know about all this complex stuff and formalized point of view in order to use it in functional programming practice. So how we use Kalan in the company? So this is a typical application architecture that we use. So on the high level, we have some like algorithms that we want to have an efficient implementation. They are all implemented above Scalan library, which has abstractions for linear algebra, for graphs, for collections. And then we have a backend. We support LMS, using LMS for efficient imperative loops and array computation. We have Spark. We can produce Delight. And we also have MPI distributed array implementation. For the same source code, SVD, SVD++, we have automatic translation to these different backends at the same time. So currently we have, if we ask about how it scales from single line, so here's implementation for machine learning, for example, logistic regression, trust region, Newton methods, it's around 150 lines of code, completely abstracted from collection representation, and it can be generated LMS arrays and MPI. We also have matrix vector multiplication for all different runtimes. We also have SVD. SVD++ is the most sophisticated implementations, 300 lines of code, but it's actually working two different, completely different runtimes. This is a sequential one, and this is distributed computation on Spark. And for other examples as well. So which project we think may benefit from this specialization technique? First of all, we think that Scala itself can benefit, and if it's possible and make some reasons to make it a first-class technique in Scala, then I think many domains can benefit from this. Spark, yes, because Spark is a functional programming framework. And functional streams, Scala-Z, which has a very nice streaming model, purely functional, and can be accelerated like this. Also, functional lenses, parsers. Yesterday was a good talk about parsers. We still have some limitations, so we rely on referential transparency. But in functional programming, this is actually good. So we have limited recursion support, so we tail recursion will be implemented soon. Now we, for many high performance scenarios, you don't actually need a recursion, but it can be added. Effects can be introduced using applicative or monads, but so actually in talking about effects, I think that capabilities approach, which Martin told about in Knode, I think this is a better way than monads and so on, because in our framework we rely on key Scala, two key Scala things. First is the classes and then is the methods. So we stage classes and methods, and functions actually is just instances of classes with the function apply. So we have staging implementation of actually for functional object-oriented language. That's why this implicit capabilities is actually very good fit for effects in terms of staging and staged evaluation in particular. So get involved. Everything is on the GitHub. You can run all the examples that I have shown. And see how it works. You can ask questions in the Google group, follow us on Twitter, and scalonize your domain. So, thank you. Yeah, please.
So when you compile Scala code to C, are you using some kind of GC, garbage collector?
Yes, we use shared pointers.
And the second question, do you support virtual dispatch?
Sorry?
Do you support virtual dispatch? That's kind of a weak point of LLS.
Yeah. So the main method how staged evaluation actually works is that we stage virtualization mechanism on the object-oriented language. We use some special techniques. I have slides, backup slides, but this is, I think, two technical details. But yes, virtual
dispatch. You mean you implement virtual table on your own, or what?
No, we just use Scala.
Yeah, but let's say you need to call back to the GVM. For example, you have a Java class which happens to reach the code which you're staging. So it means that you need to call back from C to Java.
We currently consider hotspot implementation, and everything you has dependencies in the hotspot. You can take all the dependencies. You need to have all the AST, and that's where I think it can be. The tasty is actually good for such kind of tasks. We can take all the AST of the program, put it into the kernel, and then do everything in the kernel. Okay. So we are not doing this callback since.
Okay, thanks.
So you had shown with vectors and matrices and that you can have essentially isomorphic representations and play with those. Are there other interesting types where that same thing can be done?
Yeah, actually, I have a backup slides, for this question.
Okay.
Thank you. So graphs is actually very rich for such kind of things. Not only graphs itself, but also front. If we consider the MST algorithm, we have three different implementations of the front itself. So if we take a minimum spanning tree algorithm, you need to somehow represent front and graph. And if we take just three representation of graph and three representation of this, we have nine different specializations, which we can select automatically, right? Using profiling. And multiply by two with a C++ versus Scala. So we actually have this table, and this is the winners. This is a benefit which we achieved by offloading everything to C++. So this is five times better C++ than Scala. And this happens automatically. You don't need to do anything. Just what you actually need is just to implement your algorithm in this way. So this is MST implementation. And also, this is a beautiful code. From start front initial tree until stop condition, do step. Mm-hmm. That's all the logic of the algorithm, right? And this is a functional. And we can generate imperative loops. We tried LMS. So LMS quite good in this situation particular. But first, you need to convert to arrays.
The other question I had was, so somebody needs to tell the system what kind of isomorphic representations you have.
Right.
Is that done with this hotspot annotation, or how do you do that?
Let me show. Actually, it's here. Every time you implement some concrete implementation of some abstract data type, like vector, for example, or matrix, you actually thinking about what is your data and what is your methods with this data.
Yeah.
And once you define this tuple of data, tuple of arguments for constructor, you already defining an intermediate, representation of your data. And the idea is we just need to take it as a declaration that this is an alternative representation.
I get it, yeah. And how does this framework know which of these things are the ones that it should pursue? Because I guess you have lots of case classes, and most of them don't give you much in terms of...
Yeah, and this is where this wrap and wrap pattern actually works. You, here you explicitly tell that for you, the representation is arrays because this is what data you have. Uh-huh. And you just wrap it into abstractions.
And okay.
You can select here which abstractions you use. But because we can automatically remove these abstractions, it's no problem. You first introduce these abstractions, then you remove it. Yes.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Anyone? Do you have other spare slides?
Yeah, I have main slides. Okay.
Just have a look.
How much time we have?
Don't know. 2 minutes.
2 minutes. Okay. I will just repeat. Get involved.
Okay. Thank you.